My name is Karen McNulty-Walsh, and I am the lead science writer, science communicator at Brookhaven National Laboratory. Brookhaven, for those of you who don't know, is a multidisciplinary lab on Long Island in New York. We have about 2,700 employees and about 4,000 visiting scientists every year. And many of those scientists come from universities and other national labs from the northeastern United States, around the country, and indeed around the world. Many of them are from universities. We have four Office of Science user facilities. I'm going to focus mainly on three of them today because there's a lot to talk about. We conduct research across all areas of science, from basic research on the building blocks of matter to energy research on things like building better batteries and solar cells, biological research, deciphering the structures of proteins, lots and lots of material science, including trying to understand how some materials carry electric current with absolutely no resistance to electricity, because if we could figure out how to make those things work at a reasonable temperature, we could basically solve the energy crisis. We have an energy frontier research center dedicated to that. And we also conduct a lot of environmental research, both looking at climate, looking at aerosols and particulate matter and carbon balance in the atmosphere, trying to collect data around the world from the Arctic to Antarctica to improve climate models. So we basically do everything. And I have the best job in the world because I get to write about all of it. We do sort of have a beat system at Brookhaven where some of us are the key contact for certain user facilities and certain areas of research, but in the end, we all kind of cross boundaries and write about everything, and we find that that's very useful because then we can all help promote the science across the lab and talk about this broad resource for scientists from across the country and indeed for the public, because all of the 99%, I think, of this research is publicly funded and publicly reported and has impact, you know, across all areas of science. So, you know, just to give you a little snapshot, I'm going to be pretty quick. The facilities that I'm mainly going to talk about are the Relativistic Heavy Ion Collider, which is kind of a mouthful. Basically, it's we like to colloquially call it an atom smasher. We smash the nuclei of atoms together to try to see what matter looked like at the beginning of the universe and understand more about the building blocks of matter and what holds them together. The strong force is is nature's strongest force, which is why it's called that, and it's one of the least understood. So, what is that going to benefit? How is that going to benefit society? We can't say for sure, but this is the kind of research that has fueled the development of many technologies over history, and indeed the facility itself and building the machine and the computational resources to handle the data have impacts today. So, for example, within the next month, we're going to be receiving a magnet assembly that's sort of based on the magnets we've designed to steer these atoms into these big particle accelerators that can be used to accelerate ions for cancer therapy. And we're bringing that magnet assembly to Brookhaven for testing, and it's a partnership with industry that will, we hope, end up in a commercialized proton and carbon therapy system for treating cancer. One of our accelerator physicists who's deeply involved in the work at RIC is the spearheading this Brookhaven's role in that research. Some of the, and there are about 1,000, slightly over 1,000 scientists come to RIC to use it every year. And it's a pretty consistent user community. Our messages in communicating that research tend to be globally about the major findings that are coming out. We could do a much better job in partnering with the universities or having the universities partner with us and getting those messages out. So I would love to talk about ways to establish those relationships better. I know when RIC first turned on, we did a huge effort to loop in all of the PIOs at universities that were involved in the research, but that's an ever-changing cast of characters, so it'd be great if we could talk about ways to do that better. Our next largest in terms of, our largest user facility in terms of numbers of scientists coming to use it is the National Synchrotron Light Source 2. Okay, so actually NSLS, the original, which started operations in 1982 and shut down at the end of fiscal year 14, had the most users, about 22,000, right, per year? 2,200. 2,000 is about 2,200.
Oh, I thought it was
22,000. And they come from all areas of science, environmental science, material science, a lot of life science scientists looking at biological structures. And because we are now bringing our new light source up, getting beamlines built up still, our user population has declined slightly for now, but ultimately it will be at least the same and potentially even larger. And the other one that I want to talk about is the Center for Functional Nanomaterials, where we have about 500 researchers, and much of the research there is done in partnership with our staff scientists at the CFN. A lot of it is energy related. This is where we look at batteries and superconductors and solar cells and things of that nature. And I think we have the best relationship with, or the best experience of communicating the university partnerships there and the research that's done by university scientists there, because our scientists are involved in the research. So I'm hoping that we can talk about ways that we can use that model to do better communications about light source research and RIC research across the board. Some stories that just came out in the last week, all of which had university partners, were looking at the structure of a protein that is involved in the replication of DNA and how it happens correctly, which might inform how it sometimes goes wrong, which is what happens in cancer. So that has real impact for people. A new way to generate electric current in materials that have unusual electronic properties, but they're not superconductors, but it's using magnetic and electrical fields to cause materials to have extremely low resistance to electricity. Another thing that could have huge potential. Oh, and it may happen at temperatures much warmer than superconductors operate these days. So there's a lot of new material to explore with that. We've also reported on something at the CFM where we used DNA as a building block for building nanomaterials, so materials made out of nanoparticles that kind of mimic atomic structures. In this case, we made a crystal lattice that looks like diamond, but it's at the nanoparticle scale instead of the atomic scale, and it may be able to create materials that have some of the unusual or take advantage of unusual optical and mechanical properties, just like diamond has unusual mechanical and the strength and the optical properties. We don't know exactly what yet, but kind of an interesting discovery. And we've also put out a story about a deployment of equipment to Antarctica to look at atmospheric chemistry there in a way that hasn't been done since the late 1960s to try to improve climate modeling and figure out why ice sheets are melting the way they are and understand global warming and ultimately improve our predictive capabilities. And that was done in collaboration with ORNL, which is another DOE Office of Science User Facility. We are also, I just jotted this one down at the last minute, a story about two new biologists who just came to Brookhaven who are looking at taking all that information about genomes that's coming out of plant genome sequencing and algae genome sequencing and trying to actually pinpoint what's the function of those genes and which genes have the potential to really improve plants, algae as a model for ultimately plants in biofuel production. So again, research across the board, and I'm very interested in partnering with the university scientists and PIOs who can help us communicate those stories.
Good morning. I'm Karen Keim, the communications manager at the Facility for Rare Isotope Beams at Michigan State University. So I was a former journalist when I came back, or graduated from Michigan State. Went to work in newspapers, then came back to Michigan State to work in their facilities organization where I worked for about 7 years and had some overlap with EFRIB as Michigan State competed for the facility and then won it. And then I just came to work at EFRIB in July of 2014. So I'm very new to science communications and DOE-SC. So I'm excited to meet all of you and learn from all of you too, because we are maybe unique for many of you that we are establishing a facility now. It is under construction. So $730 million facility, $635 million of that is from the Department of Energy, and then $94.5 million from the state of Michigan and Michigan State. And then Michigan State is contributing about $300 million beyond the total project cost. So it's a really big deal to the state and to the university for sure. It's expected to generate about $1 billion in economic impact and activity in Michigan. So, as I said, it's under construction now. We started civil construction in 2014 in March, and then technical construction followed in October of the same year. So we're about 10 weeks ahead of schedule right now, working toward early completion in fiscal year 2021. So we're getting there. And we're expected to create more than 1,000 new isotopes that have never been produced on Earth when we're up and running. So in very simple terms, we will accelerate a heavy ion beam, hit a target, and create rare isotope beams. And then those beams will be sent into the scientific experiment where the researchers will work their magic and discover things and put them to use in ways we don't even yet know. So it's really exciting, a lot of anticipation and hope and excitement behind it. So currently on Michigan State's campus, we have the National Superconducting Cyclotron Laboratory. And when EFRIB is complete, the NSCL will essentially be absorbed into EFRIB. We'll use the same scientific equipment. We'll be able to use a lot of that scientific equipment. So our linear accelerator will connect to NSCL's scientific equipment that is existing now. So it's also one of the unique things about our facility. So a little bit about Michigan State. It's a 5,200-acre campus. It's very close to the state capital, so we're kind of in the heart of the Lower Peninsula. An annual operating budget of $2 billion, so it's no small company or city, if you will. About 50,000 students, and we have experienced and enjoyed a long, accomplished history of nuclear physics. So for the fifth straight year, we've been the number one graduate program in the nation, as ranked by U.S. News and World Report. And each year we educate about 10% of the nation's PhD holders in nuclear physics. So I mentioned NSCL, it's been part of Michigan State for quite some time. We just celebrated 50 years since our first beam from the K50 cyclotron in the fall. So it's really exciting that EFRIB is building on that and building on what NSCL has done so well as far as educating future scientists. So that's part of the value proposition now for being part of MSU. World-class experience, better science education, close integration with STEM education. So we also benefit, we'll be our users come from the NSCL user base. So there's about 1,400 users currently using NSCL who are lined up and ready to begin research at EFRIB. So we're not communicating research at this time because we're under construction, so I was just going to talk to you a little bit about the directions of communications now for the current phases of EFRIM. So, as I said, we're under construction. So our focus has primarily been internal as we're working to make sure the project team stays committed, motivated. This is a long project, and users are really excited to be using it. So internally, we're moving our project team. I have been from first we were competing for this project and designing it, and now we've needed to transition to a production mindset and actually build it on time, on budget, within scope. And then also at the same time externally make sure our users are committed, engaged, and keeping them apprised of what our progress is. So that's sort of where we're at in the constructing phase, but we are transitioning to ramping up to the start of operations, so even though it's about 5 years away, we need to again think about shifting our mindset, that is, to from production to operating a world-class facility and delivering the promise and providing excellent opportunities for users to make their discoveries. So that's sort of next on the list. We're in that transitional phase now. Then we'll have the start of operations where again, mindset shift for our internal team, and then operations and discovery, where then I will become more like all of you and be communicating primarily externally all of the discoveries and the partnerships that are happening as a result of the facility. So primarily right now, my communications with universities are my own university, and Lane over there is from Michigan State University's university-level communications office. So as we are focused on building the facility, our university level communications team is handling most of the external communications as far as media relations and responding to inquiries from the media and from others about the project. So we work really closely together. I can say it's an excellent partnership. I'm happy to have them as a resource because right now it's me and one assistant communications manager, and then we have three students. So I'm beginning to think more about what resources and what our team needs to look like when we are operational. So I'm also excited to talk to all of you about that today. So those are the highlights I wanted to cover today. Thank you.
Hello, my name is John Basher. I'm the communications manager for computing sciences at Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory. I've been there now 19 years, and I think in lab years that's about 133 years. So I actually started this group, and I think we're pretty fortunate. Something that Dr. Murray touched on is having the importance of communication. My boss actually believes wholeheartedly in communication, so we have a four-person, four FTEs in our own communications group within computing, and we work with public affairs, but we don't work for public affairs. So that gives us a little bit more leeway, and I guess we don't have to do some of the crap they have to do, which is nice, but then we work together. And that's a sort of a standard model at Berkeley. Like JGI is also independent, and Ashley over in the corner from the Advanced Light Source has a small communications group. So it's a little different than I think some of the other labs. And that might be because we're managed by the University of California. It might be because we're in Berkeley. But the university relations are really in our DNA, because in 1931, Ernest Orlando Lawrence, our namesake, was working on campus, and he was building these cyclotrons that were getting bigger and bigger. So they finally told him to go up the hill where there was this worthless real estate overlooking the San Francisco Bay and the Golden Gate, and said, build your lab up there. So we're stuck up there overlooking campus. We are managed by the University of California, but we're not managed by UC Berkeley system-wide. So it's pretty cool. And I represent two user facilities. They're both about the largest within DOE, and they're also some of the oldest. So NERSC, which you heard about, it's not named for Dr. Seuss Animal. It's the National Energy Research Scientific Computing Center. It was started 42 years ago in Livermore when an old supercomputer from the weapons program was going to be scrapped. They said, well, we can use that. We'll let the guys at Princeton do some plasma modeling on it for fusion research. So that's how it started. And at the time, it was really radical that you'd let people in the other end of the country use a computer in California. So they dial up and they get the phone, somebody to answer it, they plug it into the acoustic modem and hope that they got it right and nobody was whistling nearby, and then they could actually send data back and forth. And that actually begat the second it's a more unusual concept of a national user facility, and that's ESnet, the Energy Sciences Network. Now, you are all users of this national user facility, whether you know it or not. So any email you send to or from a lab or to or from Rick at DOE goes across ESnet at some point. And I know Karen is a huge fan of it. She knows, because it transports almost all the data. Oh, it does all the data from the LHC experiments in Switzerland to both Fermi and Brookhaven Lab. So that was a new development a year ago. They added 300G links across the Atlantic, under the Atlantic. And so this is a backbone network of 100 gigabits per second, which is pretty fast. So what we do at NERSC is we make it real easy for the users. There's about 6,000 users, about half are in the universities. And there's this really nice handout out front, and it will show you we allocate time in terms of how many processor hours they get. So about 1 billion of our, half our 2 billion processor hours a year go to university researchers. And inside here is even a list of all the universities that have users at our facility, so it's pretty easy. We also make it easy for them to acknowledge a nurse by writing out what they should say in their acknowledgments. But we also have a carrot there. It says, if you think it's really cool, contact our communications team and they'll work with us. So, and if you pick up this dandy handout, you see this is the death throes of a primordial star. It was modeled by this project was led by a postdoc at UC Santa Cruz. And it was a really awesome image. So we plastered it on the front of this. We put it on the front of our annual report. We use it at a supercomputing conference. So we really work well with the universities. Sometimes we hear about it first because our internal people say, oh, there's a cool project. Other times we'll hear from one of the university PR offices and they'll contact us and we work with them. And one of us will usually take the lead and the other one will amplify it. And that's how it worked out pretty well. But I asked the head of our user services group at NERSC, and he said, the users really see the value of NERSC. They have to apply for time and they get it, and this is something they can't buy elsewhere. So they're really, you know, and they really want to make sure they do the best job of using these resources. So they're you know, wholeheartedly indebted to us, which we love. And then they like it when we help them get the word out about their work. They really appreciate it. They don't all have access to their local public affairs office, so we can help them in that way. And that really goes a long way. But like I said, the other one we work with is ESNet, and they're kind of strange. Their networking, their user facility comes to you. You don't have to go to it. And it connects 40 DOE sites around the country at, like I said, 100 gigabits per second. So those cat videos really scream. In fact, you're sending cat videos faster than anyone else can do on the planet. But about half, they're sending 40 petabytes a month. This goes over ESNet, which is a lot of data. About half of that is related to the experiments at the LHC. And what they're doing now is they're peering to 20 other, so typically we only connect to DOE sites, but under at a request of the Office of High Energy Physics, because of the LHC data, we're peering directly with 20 universities. So the key is that if the network is controlled from end to end, then you can get the data across a lot faster. There's fewer bottlenecks, so that's a new change. So universities will be directly connected to ESNet for the first time, and this, I think 8 are online and 12 more are coming soon. But that's only for LHC data because we don't want to get in the way of other networks. So, and that's about it that I have to say, but we really do work closely with the university. The problem with ESNet is nobody knows they're using it because it's just there. It's kind of like, you know, not everybody knows what utilities delivering water here to their hotels. And I suggest occasionally, why don't you just shut it down for an hour and then say, well, this relaxation break was brought to you by ESNet. They, you know, they don't listen to the PR guys, so come on.
So I think that was a great introduction to how rich this space is. We actually used all of the time. Not even a bit left. So I'm going to turn to that. If you want to kind of, I could see some questions going to the breakout.
So typically what we expect to do here is that the moderator then will engage the panelists in some discussion around those provocative questions, and I lied to you by telling you that those provocative questions were in your packet, but they're not. So as you listen to the panelists sort of mull these over, maybe throw back to the panel the questions that I had in mind for you, they're the following. First of all, it's the pipeline issue. So if I'm working at DOE, how do I know that one of your university PIs has done something cool? You know, if I don't see the paper and see the acknowledgement there, how do I learn about that? So that's one thing I'd like you to sort of flip the panel to doing. How should you figure out who the contact person at the user facility is that you can contact with? If you're a university, who is your contact? If you're at the user facility and you want to find out who the users are, PIOs, how do you do that? How do you find that out? And then who gets credit? So talk about sort of the credit issue and how is credit disaggregated among that system. And we'll have all these to hand out to you as you go to lunch so that you'll be able to cogitate over them during your lunch break. And then when they're done with their navel gazing internally, we'll open it up to the rest of the audience. A lot. You can go here until 10:30. I'm sorry, to 11:30.
No, I mean, we're past. We completely blew our budget. We talked about scope, cost, and schedule.
So you're scheduled 10:45 to 11:15, and then 15 to 11:30, you get to do Q&A.
I was thinking that maybe we'd take just 5 more minutes, and
sure.
I'll just.
You got
what
it.
What I'll do is I'll just seed some questions and go for responses, because I know that we'll all be in the breakout session together, right? And we'll use that time for you all to pepper. I mean, it's going to be an open free-for-all during the breakout this afternoon. But one common question, so I do think, you know, a lot of this training is great groundwork for them. And we've heard, I think, some really interesting ideas. One, just articulating the user facility. It's difficult to do compactly. It's not as a, you know, user facility as a term. I actually want to put that on the table for this afternoon. I mean, we use the term research infrastructure in other contexts. So just from the point of view of the Office of Science, even though we've used the term user facility forever, I'd actually like to even start from that point of view. Is this really the best way to describe ourselves? Or how do we answer Dave's charge to contribute to this afternoon? what is that? What does that say? And one question I want to throw to you before we give up the dais here is, what's the biggest barrier that you find to making that connection with universities? As someone who works specifically to your facility, what's that barrier?
I actually wanted to ask you, sorry, the fourth panelist, I forgot.
Since you're being recorded, please use a mic.
Sure.
I'm Martha Heil with the University of Maryland. And Karen, sorry, I can see your name now. You almost exemplify the channels of communication between a user facility and a university, right? Because you're at a university that has a user facility on it. So how do you, and you said a colleague of yours was here that probably helps transmit stories out. How do you, what's your pipeline? How do you let them know what's going on? And what are the challenges that you face?
We have monthly calls, so we chat about things that way. And then also, like I said, we're not really pushing lots out at this time, though, because we're in the construction phase. So it's more so when media inquiries come to us, then that prompts us to get together, discuss who's going to handle them, how we're going to handle them, and then share the load as far as those go, and also we have a lot of requests for different groups to come in and tour the facility. And sometimes, you know, we share that and we work through those kind of challenges and strategies together as far as fielding inquiries, and then occasionally when there's a milestone in the construction front, not occasionally, quite regularly, milestones in construction, then we may pitch to the media to bring them in to see progress. So we really, kind of in constant communication, just phone, email, normal channels about what inquiries we're having and information we want to put out. Not sure if that answered your question. But again, more to come because we know we're moving to the next phase of the facility where external communication needs to be very focused.
I can add to that in terms of, I think we are more typical in terms of having users come in to use our facilities, and as I said earlier, if there is a co-author or active participant in the research who is a Brookhaven scientist, they may let us know. Sometimes we don't find out until we get notifications from the journals that a paper is publishing, but we see that there is a university scientist as the lead author on that paper. We will often contact the university, especially if we don't have time to do something quickly ourselves. We'll contact the university to find out if they're already aware of the research and if they're planning to do something. About half the time they say, yes, we're aware, and many times they say they're not, and that they don't have the resources to do something quickly either, but we can sometimes scramble and get something out and then work with the university partner in that way. The ideal situation is when we know about it with more lead time, and you know, we would certainly, sometimes our staff scientists do let us know so-and-so has been here and has done this work and it's coming out soon, you know, when they know about it, but we do need more information coming in from the universities about publications from scientists that took place based on research at Brookhaven.
I have a tangential question for Karen King as well, and that is, having never been to East Lansing before, I don't know whether it's considered like the Berkeley of the Midwest with respect to having an activist community, and in your startup mode now, how do you triage community activism responses from your office or from your colleague at the university itself?
That's primarily handled at the university level. Those issues that are a little bigger than what we want EFRIM to necessarily be the entity of record as far as responding to them. I'm not thinking of any activism-related issues right now surrounding EFRIM, at least since I've been there, but you know, some other things that where there's been some local media attention that's handled through the university level office. So again, I benefit greatly from our relationship right now because I'm not handling all of those things on my own. So, good question.
John, as we wrap up, the very last thing, I just wanted to ask John the same question about barriers and reaching out to the university. It's such a huge user community, about 4,000 or 5,000 per year. How do you deal with that, the pipeline issue?
I don't know. actually, there seems to be a pretty steady pipeline. I guess, you know, we could probably, if we had more staff, we could do more, but there seems to be, you know, again, a lot of our users have been using the system for 20 years or more, and we've saved all their data. So we do have a huge data collection too, but they know to contact us. The users are regularly reminded to contact us, and they're reminded about the acknowledgement. So it's pretty, it just seems to work pretty well. And we work with public affairs, and if they get an inquiry, they forward it to us as well, if it's about the computing or the networking. So it's pretty good.
Well, we have the floor and transition, and we'll continue this conversation this afternoon. So thank you all very much.
So while we do our transitional phase here between panels, I'll just talk to you really quickly about the panels, and I'll ask my panelists to go up and join me here in front. So the second panel, we were interested in unpacking the issues that are around direct support through DOE of university research. And that's a really interesting piece for us because it's something that, from the Office of Sciences perspective, we hear all the time as we go up on the Hill. We hear, you know, we would love to support the Office of Sciences budget, but no, we don't have a lab in our district, so we really don't care. And a lot of the conversation we had this morning with Dr. Murray and Kay and others has been around, you know, trying to make it very obvious what this relationship is. One of the places it's easiest to do that is in our direct support. As Dr. Murray talked, there's quite a bit of money flowing out of here in direct support through grants, awards, and other mechanisms, direct support of university researchers and university research folks. So what we wanted this panel to do is take a look at those issues, and some of them are about the same. So there's a pipeline issue here as well. The pipeline issue is how do university PIOs find out about recent or impending grants and awards? So the short answer for a lot of this is going to be, I wish we knew, because we're in a little bit of a, in the Office of Science, we have a little more of a challenge in some of the other parts of DOE. And we want to have some conversations, I think, in this room and in the breakout session about how you find out from the university's perspective, how you find out about grants and awards coming to you. So that's one pipeline issue we'd like to talk about. How, as a university PIO, do you acknowledge federal support in your news products and public-facing materials? And how do we, as feds, our user facility communicators, how do we go back and help acknowledge the fact that this work was done at universities? I think there is an incomplete system here and a long way we can go to make this a more seamless process and a more useful process to us both. And whose responsibility is it that the principal investigator do the right acknowledgments? So, you know, I think a lot of times we will call up a university and say, why the hell didn't you do X, Y, or Z? We don't really do that. In fact, Kate, I think, will tell a little tale or has told a little tale from time to time about when she first, Kate will be introduced to you as our stakeholder manager for university relations. But when she starts calling up universities that haven't heard from her before, there's this sort of silence on the other end. It's like, what did we do wrong? We'll fix it. Right, what did we do wrong? It's usually not like that, right? It's usually, here's an opportunity. We'd like to help you with this. But there are times when we call and we say, gosh, you know, why did we not know this? And you will call us and you will say, damn it, Rick, why didn't I know this grant award was coming down the pike? And a lot of times our contact is with the PIO at the university. And I think that we sort of assume, to our detriment across the board, that that PIO at the university knows that this grant has been negotiated with their university, that something has happened that alerts her or him that this is going on. And the more we find out, the more we find out that we're often telling the university PIO what has been negotiated at their university and that the PI isn't talking to the PIO. And so we help make that. That's a great thing. We love doing that. But there's got to be a better way. So part of the conversation here is about the better way.
Well, Rick, you know that our job description is last to know, first to tell.
Exactly. So there's got to be a better way to do that. And I've tasked this panel to sort of think about some of those issues and do that. And they're going to run for the full hour. I think I'll put a plug at a quarter of in an hour, unless the questions peter out before that, which will be fine. The person I've tapped to do this panel is Patrick Glynn. Many of you, almost everyone from the labs or user facilities knows Patrick as the person in SC2, that science unit within the Office of Science, that looks over the accuracy and ameliorates the discussion and disputes that arise over the how hyped a news release might be or those kind of things, and does a tremendous job of that. He manages, handles somewhere on the order of 500 news releases a year coming out of the system. So it's, you know, it's not even his full-time job. He also does other stuff. I don't know when, but he also does other stuff. So he's the right person to help us, you know, guide through some of these issues around how we do public affairs work and public communication around our portfolio, both the research portfolio we do at the labs, but especially from the perspective of direct support. So, Patrick, if you would take it over.
Thanks, Rick. Thanks very much. And I want to thank Rick for organizing this great meeting. It's really good to see a lot of familiar faces, and I think it's really valuable for us. My wife usually says I don't need a microphone.
You do.
So we turned on. What do I do?
Okay.
Here? You wouldn't believe that DOE were technologically challenged. Thanks very much.
Much better.
Okay, welcome everybody. I think we've got a great panel here for talking about the whole task of amplifying findings from DOE research. We've got some real experts in this business. But just to set the stage, I wanted to go back a few years and maybe even a few decades to the end of World War II. It seems like a long time ago. But one of the most important strategic decisions that the United States made at that point in time was to come to the conclusion that major federal support for basic science was going to be essential to the country. This was really a new idea. Prior to World War II, the entire research budget of the federal government was about less than $70 million. It was not a big priority. But obviously, World War II became a kind of a technological race all by itself with the development of radar and sonar. But the phenomenon that really crystallized this view, of course, was the creation of the atomic bomb. I mean, nobody could have seen, almost nobody, except the people who really knew about nuclear particle physics, that this abstruse branch of science would actually hold the key to a weapon that would end the war. And the morality of its use is still debated, obviously. But there was an absolute connection, an epiphany moment, where people understood that mastery of the most basic science was going to be crucial to a nation, to our nation, for guaranteeing our security, our prosperity, and our health going into the future. And the interesting thing to me in coming to this office a few years ago is that we are the direct heirs of that process. Our office, if you ask why there's a peculiar Office of Science in the Department of Energy, the answer is that we started life as the Division of Research of the Atomic Energy Commission, the direct heirs of the Manhattan Project. And to my left are communications directors for two laboratories, Argonne and Oak Ridge, both of which began life as secret sites for the Manhattan Project to build upon. So this runs very deep in our DNA. And in the immediate years following World War II, we were really the 800-pound gorilla. We had the biggest research budget. But the interesting thing about a democracy is that even when a democracy makes a major strategic decision, as happened at the end of World War II, it's not a done deal for all time. Because the way our system works, that deal has to be re-ratified year after year after year by Congress. Why? Because Congress provides appropriations on an annual basis. And that's why the business that we're in is so important, because to get the Congress to do that, the Congress has to see a need, and for the Congress to see a need, we have to be able to tell our story in a convincing and a persuasive way.
And that's really the task, particularly from where I sit in the department as I see it. That is primarily what we're trying to do. We're taking $5 billion of tax money and we're delivering it to the field for excellent science. But we've got to get that tax money first before we can do anything and to sustain American competitiveness and strategic security. That's an important part of the puzzle. It still depends on us telling our story in an effective way, day after day, week after week, and month after month. We've got four great panelists here today. I just want to introduce them briefly. They may want to say a little bit more about what they do. Marissa Newhall is the department's director of digital and strategic communications. And an illustration of the importance of Marissa's role is the fact that an obscure company called Facebook has now the fifth largest market capitalization of any Fortune 500 company. This new media, this social media, has really taken our lives by storm at every level, and that is the arena in which Marissa works. Dave Keim is communications director at Oak Ridge National Laboratory, and before that, had, I think, even maybe a tougher job as communications director for Y-12. What he has brought to the table, and which is really very, very valuable to our whole community, is about 16 years as a frontline reporter and editor, so he has real experience on the ground from the other side. Matt Howard is director of communications at Argonne National Laboratory. Matt, I almost want to say, is a DOE fixture. He's been around for a long time. He's been extremely active. He's a DOE guy. He's extremely active in the National Association of Communications Directors and really, really does know the department. And then my colleague, Kate Bannan, is really our main liaison to the university communications community. And everybody's been remarked on how tremendous a job Kate's been doing in terms of capturing research results from the university. Before she came to us, she was at the University of California office here for a long time, but she was also co-founder and for many years the chairman of the Energy Sciences Coalition, which is a group in town that I would say is our best friend in Washington. So Kate has had a lot of experience in this area. But so welcome to all of the panelists, welcome to all of you. And Marissa, I wonder if you could get us started.
Thank you for that nice introduction, and thank you to Rick for inviting me to be here today. As Patrick mentioned, among the many hats that I wear in DOE's Public Affairs Office, I manage a digital content team that works out of Public Affairs. We do it a little differently here at the Department of Energy than a lot of cabinet level agencies do. We have objectively an embarrassment of riches in terms of resources for digital content and social engagement. So on my team, I manage four digital content specialists who are really like beat reporters for the entire universe of the Department of Energy. Those folks split all of the program offices and topics that we have here. And then I have three multimedia producers as well. We have a full-time video producer, we have a full-time graphic designer, and then we have someone who produces data-driven interactives and visuals. So really, you know, this is our answer to how do we get out there and tell this story of what's going on at the Department of Energy. And I can get more into this as we go. I think today, my real value here is to give everyone a glimpse into how we're tackling this question of telling stories and reaching broader audiences, and to give you a glimpse of what opportunities may be there, whether it's something you'd like to explore yourself or ways we could partner with you and others at the department and at the labs to get this going. So I'm excited to engage in the conversation.
As Patrick said, I'm a newspaper guy for a couple of decades before I went to work for Y-12. It's really not hard to be communications for a nuclear weapons plant. You're not allowed to communicate.
Great job.
Everything's fine. My background is not in science, and so but Oak Ridge National Laboratory is one of the, as far as I'm concerned, best places
that you can be a public affairs person, because it's just the embarrassment of riches that you have to work with. I'm really glad that there's so many university representatives here. It struck me in the earlier presentations that the funding for science in this country, if I read the chart right, went to the National Science Foundation first and then to the Department of Energy second. And I'm also struck by Kay's point that he knows that the Office of Science is the largest funder of the physical sciences, but he's not sure many other people do. So how do we change that? Well, from my old newspaper guy's seat, I don't care where the money comes from. That's the challenge when it comes to talking about what we do. If it's a great science story, or if it's a controversial science story, it's easy to get coverage. Unfortunately, often that's coverage you don't necessarily want. When you put out stories proactively about science, how do you make sure that you're reinforcing the importance of the Office of Science to that work? And I think that's sort of where the rubber meets the road for me, and I'm really glad there are so many people in this room with such great attendance to help us try to find answers to that question. I have some ideas, and I look forward to the discussion, and hope that we can come out of this day working together, because I think our interests are aligned. I think there's something in it for all of us to do a better job of articulating the importance of the Department of Energy's science funding.
I've never been called a fixture before, so this is, I think I should. No. So I'm Matt Howard from Argonne National Laboratory. When Rick and Patrick invited me to participate in this, I was thinking, and after we had our first planning call, why should we care? And then how do we make a change? So why should we care is what I've been preoccupied with, and I think, and give us all a reason to care. The slides that both Cherry and Kay presented tell a really good picture of funding. However, if you think of it in the context of the overall share, R&D funding, federal investments in R&D as a percentage of the national budget and of GDP, it's been on a steady decline since the 70s. And so what that means is the pie is not getting bigger, it's actually shrinking relative to other parts of the federal government. And that means our slices are shrinking. And so if we're going to, and that's the why, and I think that's a compelling why that we all could share, both at a national lab and at a university. Secondly, I thought, well, what is the better way? I like that phrase, and maybe that's a good way to think about how do we connect with each other and how do we carry each other's stories better? And I want to give one example of something that that was is a success at Argonne, but it's broader than Argonne, and I think it's an ideal model if I can continue to develop things like this. We launched the Joint Center for Energy Storage Research a few years ago, and the idea behind it is to develop a battery with 5 times the energy storage capabilities at 1/5 the cost in 5 years. And the idea is both from a basic science standpoint, developing better cathodes and electrodes and anodes, but also prototyping. So you're actually trying to drive science to technology very fast. And the partnership is not just Argonne working on this, it's 14 partners, 4 university partners, 5 lab partners, and 5 industrial partners, I believe. Plus an affiliate network of hundreds of companies from around the country. And when we started planning for we knew the FOA for this hub would drop, we gathered together our partners, and we started acting together, the communication side, a year before the FOA dropped. So we were engaged with one another, we were talking about how we would actually try and win this, what our strategy is. And it's a rare opportunity that a communications office has to be at the front end of a process. I mean, how many of us are at the tail end where we get the news, we get the scientists coming up, oh, I'm published in Science, and we hand the paper, and it was out yesterday, and that's a loss for everyone, right? But how do you do that organizationally? How do you get structure within your own organization, the communications function at the front end of something, in order to build the networks and build the value over time so that we can do the winning and carry each other's stories down the line? Today, after we launched JC's, or I stepped away and we hired someone to run the communications function for that, and he's maintained that close network of the institutions, and they're going around the country and doing roadshows, affiliate roadshows, with the goal of engaging industry, engaging utilities, engaging small business in different geographies around the country. So the university partners are engaged, the lab partners are engaged. We're really trying to tell that story. And the idea being that other folks can carry the message. And so when I think about today, and I'm looking across the room here, and I'm thinking of the great convening power of the Department of Energy and the Office of Science in bringing us together, I think that's something that we each should take back with us to our own home institutions and look to leverage that. So Chicago, I'm lucky I have a wealth of top-tier research institutions outside of the laboratory at Northwestern, University of Chicago, University of Illinois, Wisconsin, Michigan, not so far away. And what can we do collectively to engage each other early and often? And that would be the one message I would put forth.
So I wanted to start out and just saying thank you to everybody in the labs and the user facilities and the universities. We started about 15 months ago, we wanted to step up and do more with universities because you all had long been involved with the department, been leaders, participate in just about every aspect of our office, and it's not always been recognized as much as it should have been. So, you know, thank you. It's been a pleasure to work with everybody and very fun, and it's terrific to get to meet the faces actually I've been talking to on the phone and by email. So one of the first things we did to really step up what we're doing with universities was redesign our website. We now have a section that's University Research Highlights. And Rick tasked me with, we want two new stories a week. And I go, okay, that sounds great. And of course, then I go into my office, close the door and panic, thinking, how am I going to find two a week? Turns out that was not a worry. You all are putting out a lot of terrific features and news releases on your research, and we ended up with about a 40% share of all of the headlines that come out on the website. So congratulations, keep it up. Thank you for sending them proactively. We do have in your folder how to work with us. We're expanding some of the things we're doing. We are including you all on Twitter now, and thanks for retweeting what we're putting out. We're also looking for YouTube videos. We need an acknowledgement, and we're looking for just short ones, but we run them every day, and leadership sees them, so it's another opportunity for you, and we do have our own YouTube channel. Please continue to post on Greek Alert and NewsWise. We're getting lots of eyes on those pages as well, and it's a good opportunity for everyone. We work with, as Dr. Morgan said, 300 plus universities, small, public, private, every state, and it's amazing how much work is getting done. We see you in grants. You make announcements and have news releases on those. You do a lot of work at our user facilities. You get our early career awards, so there are a lot of opportunities for you to have news. We are going to do some proactive communication with you. I promise not to spam you, but if we have big reports that come out or grant announcements, I will be sending them. If you have other ideas, if there are other things you'd like us to communicate, let us know. We're going to continue to keep this dynamic, and I know that each university has a unique setup who you report to, what you report on, what your portfolio is, but I do know that there is no one who has the Office of Science as their sole area of interest, so we appreciate everything you do. We're probably one of many agencies. To be your favorite, but please don't hesitate to contact me or any of my colleagues if we can help you with something or if you have ideas. And thanks again.
Thanks so much, Kate, then Matt, and Marissa. Marissa, I wanted to start with you because when we had a conversation prior to our a meeting, you had mentioned that you had a lot of metrics, and I'm really curious to see, with particularly in the new media, who you're reaching, how you understand your audience, and are you aiming at a particular segment of the population, or are you aiming at everybody? Just like to get a sense of what your audience is.
Sure. First off, I like to provide a little context before I start talking about any analytics numbers. You know, energy.gov, which is the primary public-facing web platform for the Department of Energy, is a very large website. Every program office, for the most part, has a presence there, and we get about 2 million new visits a month, 2 million total visits, and 66% of those are new users. So our traffic is pretty high, and you know, my team that I mentioned earlier is not necessarily trying to reach every single person that's coming to that website. Each program office and staff office has its own stakeholders, its own audiences. We would never try and tell those folks how to reach those people most effectively. So to delve a little more into that context, we did a recent analytics overview, just sort of to get a flavor of the breakdown of the types of people that are coming to that giant website as a whole. About 36% of the visitors are what I would categorize as homeowners or people that are coming to us through Google searches looking for ways to save money on their energy bills. So that's why you see a big presence on energy.gov for Energy Saver. A fun fact I like to tell everyone is that actually the energy.gov homepage is half of the monthly page views of the EERE homepage, our Office of Energy Efficiency and Renewable Energy. Not a bad thing, it just means that there's a lot of people coming to our site for content that the EERE program offices put out and they're finding it. So we have the 36% that are homeowners looking for energy efficiency type information. Then we have about 33% who are what I would call invested stakeholders. So those are people who they're looking specifically for something that the Department of Energy has that no one else has. So whether that's reports, white papers, information on grants, you know, research findings, that type of thing. Those are invested stakeholders that know what they're looking for and they know to come get it. Then we get to the smallest segment of that audience, which is what I like to call the curious consumers of pop science information. So that's less than 10%. It's not the vast majority. Again, I work in just one office at DOE, right? So my team is tasked with growing that smaller audience, okay? Which is, I call them curious people because they don't necessarily know anything about the Department of Energy. They might have no idea that we have national labs, okay? So they're getting to us because they see someone shared an infographic that we created on Twitter or Facebook. They think it sounds cool. They come in, they look at that infographic, they're very task-oriented, they take information from it, and then they leave. So that group generally on the website, what we call the bounce rate, which is where you come in, you get one thing, and then you immediately leave. They have the highest bounce rate of those three groups. So my team, you know, we're really thinking of ways to engage that group of curious visitors. How do we capture their attention? How do we learn more about what they're interested in? And how do we tell them better stories about what's going on at the Department of Energy? So when we talk about social media, the enterprise level social media accounts, you know, we've grown the audiences of those heavily over the last couple of years. Our Twitter account, the @energy account, which is the primary one, is approaching 285,000 followers. We manage Secretary Moniz's social media. He has skyrocketed in popularity, especially since the Iran deal was announced. So that's approaching 38,000 followers. And you know, on Facebook, we're also still seeing some growth for our top level page. We have about 90,000 likes now, apparently. So the top content that we see people engaging with, you know, on the website and on social media, falls really into four categories. We've got energy efficiency, not a surprise, because that homeowners group is so large. Renewable energy is also huge. People are very interested in stuff that's a little wonkier than you would expect. We do Twitter chats where we bring in an expert from the national labs. You know, and this is also a great opportunity. You know, we could be featuring folks from universities as well. You know, we could be doing that. We'll sit them down for an hour and we'll say, ask this person who's working on more efficient wind turbine blades. You know, ask them whatever you want. And we get tons of questions. People really enjoy that access to our researchers and our experts. Then science, anything really having to do with science research, cool new gadgets, you know, anything that's consumer, that touches consumers in a particular way also really resonates. Because for us, we're trying to take this out of the press release. We're trying to take this out of the, you know, the white paper, the PDF. You know, no one, most of the people that interact with us on social media, we assume they're probably not going to read the executive summary of something, right? So how do we make this matter to them? And how do we really connect their lives with it? So science and the national labs in particular has been a huge charge of Secretary Moniz to find better ways to communicate about that. You know, so my team has been trying really hard to reinvent the way that we coordinate with the labs, and instead of asking them for arbitrary content, trying to ask them what's important and how we can elevate it up through our channels. And then the fourth area of interest is really anything related to climate change, which the good news for us at the Department of Energy is that almost everything we do can somehow be related to climate change. And I will throw out actually that for the Department of Energy, finding really pointed ways to communicate about climate change contributions has been a challenge for us. I'd say that's been a challenge on our team. We can talk about the importance of research and new technology, but elevating stories, particularly about research that's directly related to the effects of climate change, has been harder for us to tease out. So if anyone has any ideas, we'd love to hear them. But does that answer your question?
And I was going to say that we have a kind of a similar phenomenon in that I think in the Office of Science, most of the people that come to our website come with a very practical purpose. You know, usually money is somewhere in the equation.
That's why I go there.
You just go and you press a button and the money comes. But the spectator traffic, the people, but we do feel an obligation, and Rick and his team have done a great job providing science content. But, you know, I would say, I don't know the exact numbers, but most of the users are coming because they have a practical purpose. But you did raise a question that I think is interesting, and it's a philosophical question, almost, that could be of interest to a lot of people in the audience, and that is, and it's very close to my heart, the status of the press release. There was a work by a German literary critic called The Work of Art in the Age of Mechanical Reproduction, which was actually an acknowledgement of a revolution whereby you could take photographs now and therefore work in paintings. So my question has to do with the status of a press release in the age of the World Wide Web and new media. I still deal with those are kind of my bread and butter, in addition to some press release like feature stories that go on the web. But I'm just wondering, Do you think it's changed? What's the meaning of a press release now? Is there a residual value? How do you look at it as a result of all of these other possible ways of communicating? And I'm particularly interested in the two communications directors.
Really, very quickly. Yeah. I actually will say I think there's definitely a role for the press release. I don't think, you know, as we move into this brave new world, I think it's unwise to forget all of the things that we bring from the past. You know, I think for us, not every press release has something that's going to translate to effective digital media. It's, you know, it's knowing when to do it and when not to. And there are many topics that the Department of Energy Public Affairs team puts out press releases about that actually the press release performs better in analytics than a blog post, because really the blog post or the social media is not offering anything different.
If you give me a cup of water, I'll answer your question.
Yeah, there was.
I agree that press releases serve a purpose, but I think you have to be really clear on what that purpose is. I think often in our worlds, scientists, researchers, and administrators equate the press release with what we do. Hey, we need a press release on this. Call Keim. You know, that's not the right question. The right question is, what do you want to accomplish? Who are you trying to reach? And thank you. And what exactly do you want out of this communication? When I was still doing news, I got a lot of press releases as an editor, and I read the headline, and I read maybe the first sentence, and I knew whether I was going to do a story about it or not, or assign it. I don't need a lot. Secondly, in science communication, there are a lot of aggregators that pick up our stuff. So I think it's good to have the release so that you can say, this is what we as a laboratory want to say about this topic. Because some people will just print it as is. It also gives you something for your site that sort of has a record there that you can always have. But if you're relying on sending a release out into the wild and getting a lot of coverage that's actually substantive coverage, high-profile coverage, I don't think it's that easy, unless it's a really interesting topic. I think what is important is to think about multimedia. And can you create infographics? Can you do videos? How are you using social media? And to provide access to the experts. You know, Rick is longtime friends with Joe Palka from NPR. And when Joe came to Oak Ridge, Rick put him in touch with us. And I asked Joe, well, what do you want to do when you're at Oak Ridge? He was going to give a lecture at the University of Tennessee. So what do you want to see? We could do additive manufacturing, we could take you see the supercomputers, we could do neutron science and material science. And he said, I don't care about any of that, just give me a good talker. Yeah. And I said, well, on what topic? He said, I don't care what topic it is, I just need a good talker. I think if you're, this idea that you need to deliver a press release and then we'll check the box and all is well, starts to aggravate you. I'll try not to get worked up in front of you, but, you know, the conversation we need to have is, who's going to talk to reporters that respond to this press release? Well, we don't really want to talk. Isn't the press release enough? No. Can we do a video? Can we do an infographic? Who can design that? Who can work with us on that? Well, just go write it up. It's not that hard. You know, you have to you have to build those relationships with, so that you can identify what really matters and what's really the point. What are they trying to accomplish? And it's not to put the burden of communication on the scientists. Scientists aren't paid to be popular communicators. They're paid to do science. It's our job to translate that science. So building those relationships and really making sure we've identified the right question, I think, is important. Press releases still have a place. We have to think much more broadly than that, though, if we're going to be effective, and if we're going to also capitalize on what DOE is.
I'll say just a few things not to belabor. I agree with everything David stated. The press release is a forcing function. It allows you to get everyone on the same page. It allows you to think about what additional messages do you want to carry within your institution. Sometimes the science that you're conveying may allow you to have a higher level conversation about something that is of great interest to your president or to your leadership at your institution. It also allows you to get on the same page with your sponsor and to analyze what other partners are participating in this, if you can get to it far enough in advance that it's not just something which is communicating the science. So we can add to that checklist the, can we talk about the value of federal investments in science in this in some fashion? Is this a partnership? Is it a big result from a partnership that has been ongoing for decades to solve a particular problem? And you can tie it into that higher level. That said, press releases, they're just one tool in the toolkit. You need to think about the producing rather than writing. And that's something that we're not 100% there with where we are at Argonne, but if we had more time, we can produce quality materials, videos, slideshows, think about how this fits into the context of perhaps an event with speakers and who can you get at the podium, your sponsor, your delegation rep, your scientists who can talk well. So it's with more time, as you know, we often don't get time, but with more time, you can do a lot more and actually find a way to engage different audiences. So there is still a role for a press release, but I'd say it needs
to be... So I'm not out of a job.
Not quite yet.
Yeah, and the last question, just to wrap up. One of the things that has happened, and I know this from the program, science program side, is we have a lot more partnering going on between national laboratories and universities than we did in the past. And probably the first, something I was involved in, the Bioenergy Research Center, really kind of set the paradigm, and then the Energy Frontier Research Centers did this somewhat more manageable, a smaller scale. And then the hubs that Secretary Chu advocated are doing the same thing, and you own one of those, and Oak Ridge owns one of the Bioenergy Research Centers. So my question is, is that a correct perception from your standpoint? Are you engaging in more collaboration just in the natural course of events with university partners? And then a question about what we could do to somehow enhance or amplify that.
For JCs, as I mentioned earlier, we are actively engaging our partner set. It's the best way for us to enable the sharing of stories that are compelling. We try to provide them with resources as well so that they have a clear sense of how to narrate what JCs is doing and what it's trying to accomplish so that the goal being a great result that comes out of Stanford or comes out of Michigan correctly describes the engagement and why it's valuable at a higher level. That said, we also want to give the universities a lot of freedom to tell the stories of research discoveries. And so it's not the case that we're trying to control or anything, but we are trying to actively engage. We do that, I would say this, scientists are much better collaborators than communications people. Think about what they do, and how they see themselves within an institution. I'll go talk to my high energy physicists, and I ask them what they do and what they care about, and they see themselves as part of this global community of high energy physicists. They don't see themselves as an employee of a national laboratory that's funded by the Department of Energy. And they're collaborating on a different level, and they do it with great ease. Not to say they're not competitive, they are. Communications folks, we tend to tell our own stories and our institution stories. There may even be, I'm sure you'll find in your shop, there's writers who don't take criticism well. They want to tell their story. So ceding some control and letting your, tell the institution story, tell that partnership story, and making those connections regionally, if you can convene something, and so I can pick up and pick up the phone and call my colleague at Michigan, and we can brainstorm about how to do something that adds value for both of us. That's the real key.
Our university partnerships have grown a great deal in recent years. Obviously, with the University of Tennessee, we have a very strong formal partnership because UT is in partnership with Patel Memorial Institute to operate the lab. And David Goddard is here from the University of Tennessee, and Jeff Gary runs communications for the Oak Ridge Leadership Computing Facility, and Katie Pathay works with neutron scientists, spallation neutron source from high-flux isotope reactor. And so in their unit facility communications, they are highlighting researchers from other universities and getting that word out. And we benefit a great deal from the partnership with the University of Tennessee because we have joint faculty and we have a student pipeline. And so they have, it expands our communication shop, right? They have a lot more people than we have, and if we can work in partnership, it taps into a different communications network. It allows production of different products for different audiences, and the key there is to make sure they understand the expectations that if this is DOE funded, here's how you properly credit it. I think there's a lot of basic sharing that can benefit all of us in this space. You know, when we have these multi-partner research centers, to me that means you have 20 people who can put out the same story to all their different networks. Follow the labs that work with your university. Every time one of those pieces of work comes across your desk, are you following that laboratory? There's just a natural churn that's going to happen there that's going to benefit all of us. Do you follow the Department of Energy and the Office of Science? I think formal structures like creating a space like ATIP for university news gives us somewhere to funnel those good stories. So just awareness that that's happening I think is really important. And recognizing, I'm sorry, I'm going beyond your question. But recognizing how we can help one another. You know, one of the ways that universities can help the labs is that you can tell stories to a different, to an audience that isn't going to pay attention to national lab news. The way that I think we can help you is, I think, and I'm biased, but Matt and I think it's, if I can speak for you, Matt, it's inherently cool if you're doing work on one of the nation's most powerful supercomputers. Wouldn't that be a nice angle to include in your news about your researcher? I just think that there are mutual benefits that we can have if you as university communicators understand the uniqueness and the importance of user facilities in our national science narrative. You know, that is a really tangible way to communicate the importance of the Office of Science, that our national competitiveness depends upon the effectiveness and availability of those facilities. That's a message all of us ought to be carrying, and through repetition, getting that into the cultural milieu. I mean, it's easy when you're doing a space shot. You know, everyone pays attention to science then. Everyone paid attention to science during the Manhattan Project. But there's a whole lot going on right now in relation to clean energy and grid modernization, vehicle technology. We need to bring all of that together because it is to all of our benefit if the Office of Science continues to be well-funded. Well, as has been communicated this morning, people need to know we exist and what we do and why it matters. So that's wanted to make sure I got that in. Nobody wanted to.
Anyone else want to add?
I was just going to say, if there's anything we can do to help facilitate communicating, let us know. I know a couple of times we've seen that Nature has a paper coming out, and I'll see two or three universities in contact, all three of them, and they don't know what each other are doing. And completely understandable, you don't always know when the paper's coming out. Researchers don't always tell you. Imagine that, right? And you're busy, and you don't have time to contact the other universities. So we'll keep you in the loop from our side as much as we can, but I think having meetings like this or other big annual meetings are helpful too, because we can get to know each other and see each other in the same room and have lunch together, which facilitates communicating. It's not going to make it perfect, but I think we're all conscious that we can coordinate and put out a press release together or similar aspects of one project. So we're all in this together, and we sure do appreciate all of the acknowledgement.
Okay, I think there's some time for a couple questions. And please use the microphone on the other side. Go for it.
I'm Andrea Messer from Penn State. I've been a science writer for 40 years, and at Penn State for 27. Judging from a lot of government press releases that I've seen, I understand why you think they're dead. I haven't written ever in my career a press release or a news release. I write news stories. That's a problem for you guys, because the interesting and important thing isn't the Department of Energy. In fact, when I write my news releases, often it's not even Penn State. But I do think that good news stories are really important at this point, and it's not just aggregators who pick them up. It's everyone who picks them up. We get somewhere between 3,000 and 4,000 hits a quarter, and that's just research stories. That's not university stories. So I certainly wouldn't discount news stories. And if you're going to tweet, or you're going to put a Facebook thing out, or Snapchat, or whatever, you need to know what the story is to start with, and you can always start with the news story. So I would disagree with what was said about news releases, although I guess I don't write news.
It's a really good point. I think when we write stories coming out of Argonne, press releases or feature stories or what have you, we do write them in a way that we hope will, we know, will get picked up verbatim. Challenging times as they are, there aren't as many outlets that will care to write their own stories. And so we write them in a way that encourages pickup and tries to tell the exciting story of research. Of course, we're also mindful of other priorities, organizational and departmental. But we do, we follow other paths as well. We pitch a lot. We try to use social media to tell stories, certainly through video as well.
I appreciate the distinction that you write news stories, and I also appreciate your appreciation society, that some government releases are just blah. Well, that's part of how you can help us out. There are some topics that you all can cover much more energetically and interestingly than we might be able to do for various reasons. And that I'm not trying to criticize DOE, and I hope I don't get in trouble for saying that, but I think that universities have more freedom in certain ways to tell the story better. And so this relationship is really important to us for that reason too.
Just to add to the echo chamber, I mean, I started my career in journalism as well. So to me, really the good story is the most important thing, and reporting skills are important, asking the right questions. On my team, writing a tweet or a Facebook post is really the last part of the process. And it's as you're planning how you're gonna roll out the content that you created to tell your story. And so I think that's quality content talks. I mean, that is what gets your message out. If you don't have quality content or a good story to tell, then you don't have any business on social media, honestly. So I agree, it's very important.
Hi, I'm Sarah Charlie. I'm the U.S. Press Officer for DOE and NSF-funded Large Hadron Collider Research. So I don't think this will come as a surprise to anyone, but the most challenging part of my job and many people's jobs is both
finding a compelling story and telling a compelling story, and then also including all the information, as well as all the quotes from all the people, from all the organizations who somehow contributed. So my question is, I was wondering how your departments and your offices see this balance and find this balance, and what we can do in order to create better news stories and press releases that get the most, biggest bang for their buck, both giving the best information as well as telling a compelling story.
Okay. You know, you're talking about a sort of a perennial challenge that I'm not sure there's a single answer to. I will say that what you're talking about is the balance between what perhaps a scientist or administration at your facility wants to communicate. You want every single quote, everyone needs to be quoted, everyone needs to be listed, all this very technical information needs to be in there, or it won't get approved, with what people will actually read. One option is to put something on the web that includes what everybody likes and then doing a shorter version that goes out. It's important to have advocates like Patrick, because I think we need to use one another as bad guys sometimes. Well, you know, DOE Office of Science needs us to be 500 words. You know, that's sort of their expectation or whatever it is.
This would never get approved.
This would never get approved. So, I mean, seriously. So what we're talking about is the position of communications in an organization. Are you respected as a professional who knows best or not? I mean, if we're slide monkeys, then I guess sometimes we have to be slide monkeys. Here's your slide. You know, pays the same. But hopefully we can build enough credibility that people will understand that for this message to get out the way you want it to get out, I would recommend that you do this and this and this. And that just takes time to build credibility, to have a good plan, to show that you have your act together, and in some cases to provide an outlet. And I think the web gives us a lot of flexibility we didn't used to have. Because you can put a million words on a website. And that's one way that perhaps you can satisfy that demand. But I think working together and figuring out how to get the message out in alternate ways, like through a university partner, or making sure we understand Patrick's or Rick's expectation and using that as leverage, I think it'd be helpful too, if we, you know, we could take some political sensibility.
I think it's LHC is really tough, because you can say a zillion collaborators, and I don't know how to manage it, but I will say this, I don't think anybody missed the Higgs boson. So they do get the message out.
We have time for one last burning question, if there is one. Otherwise, we're standing between you and lunch. So. Oh, Errol, come right up.
Good afternoon. My name is Daryl Lovell. I work at Cornell University in the Media Relations Office. And I really like what you're talking about getting more involved in like digital content. I guess a question for you, Marissa, is, and anyone, is just what are some good examples of things that you've done in the past that have gotten great, like social media hits and things that you're like, wow, I never expected it to take off like that, because I'm really interested in doing more on our social media channels.
Man, that's a hard question to answer. There's lots of different stuff. So I think for me, it's really starting with, you know, just as if you were sitting down to write a press release, right? You've got, what's the end goal here? What are we actually trying to communicate? What's the most important thing about this? From there then, for us across the board, making something visually compelling and interactive, those are really the gold standards for hoping something will perform pretty well. So also creating things of genuine utility to the people who are gonna see them, maybe in a way they didn't realize. So one example that was a pretty good success for us a few years ago was an interactive tool called eGallon. And it was it fell into the sustainable transportation bucket of our communication priorities. But basically, we built this widget where it sucks in data from a couple of different APIs, and you can tell it what state you live in, and based on the most current gas prices, it'll tell you how much it would cost to fill up your car per gallon at the pump versus if you had an electric vehicle and you were charging it. It kind of does this weird algorithm and converts it out in a way that sort of makes sense. Now, given the plummeting gas prices, that number is closer today on that tool than it was 3 years ago when we released it. But it was a component of a big press release as well. So this, I think, is a good example of how the press release is still relevant. You know, the press release went out, and we were able to launch this tool at the same time. So it was plugged in the press release, and then we promoted it on social media. And so folks who never would have looked at that press release also went and checked it out on the website. And so that's been one of our most popular tools. Other content, this stuff is really surprising. We've done a lot of explainer content in the last couple of years. You know, everything you need to know about X, or how blank works, how a wind turbine works, you know, things like that. The most popular article on energy.gov of all time, it frequently, without active promotion, is the top viewed article every week, is an interactive timeline called History of the Light Bulb. It's a great piece of content. If you Google it, it'll come right up because we have very good search engine optimization. The only thing we can figure is that there's probably a bunch of like 8-year-olds that are doing reports, which makes me happy because there's good information in there. But you know, it goes through the history, you know, back to Thomas Edison, and then it weaves in as you go milestones from the solid state lighting program at the Department of Energy and research that we've funded, and you know, products that have come out of that research, and efficiency standards. So it really tells a big picture story in an interactive way. So those are just a couple of examples. But really, it's how do you take something that might be a little dry and think about how you would explain it to your mom or to your cousin, you know, because they're probably not going to go read the whole thing.
That's a great endpoint. I don't want to cut you off, Dave, but I'm going to cut you off. Thank you guys very much. I really appreciate it. Patrick, do you have any last thing to share?
Just to thank the panel. It's been a great time. Thank you very much.